Okay, we can start. Good afternoon to all of you. Thank you for joining us. So we have a special guest today. I think we have the honor and pleasure to have Eliezer Rabinovici here. I can claim, I think it's true, that he's probably one of the most influential theoretical physicists in the world. Not only because Eliezer is one of the leaders for his research in many aspects of quantum theory and string theory, and he has been having a very important career over the years with a very diverse group of collaborations, but also he has been playing a key role in many aspects of physics, I would say high energy physics in general, but only physics physics in general. And so I can say several things about Eliezer. He has been playing a key role in putting together different communities of physicists. And so I have the pleasure to know him for many years, and we are friends, and we're always meeting in many different places, and we always share different experiences. And it is hard to go to a place where something important is happening in physics when you don't see Eliezer. Yes, I remember seeing him in the 60th anniversary at CERN, and I was getting worried that I haven't seen Eliezer yet, but then suddenly he appeared. So it was something that, you know, that if Eliezer is there, everything is under control. And also when I came here, I realized that there was an activity that it had been co-organized by ICTP, the Institute for Advanced Studies in Princeton, and a group of theoretical physicists to organize an activity that is happening regularly in Crete, just to put together different communities of theoretical physicists, field theory, string theory, and so on, from different countries, from Pakistan to Israel to Iran and so on, and there's a meeting in Crete, which ICTP has been involved, participating in the organization and funding. And I didn't know when I came here, but very early, after my arrival, Eliezer made sure that I will know about it, so that we can continue supporting this activity, and we have been supporting it since for the past 9 years. What concerns today, I think Eliezer has played a key role, one of the most important persons behind this project of SESAME, and that's what the talk is about. I learned from him, actually, in a meeting in Singapore that I personally didn't know either, that the beginning of SESAME came also when I discussions that ideas that came from Abdul Salam. So it's one of the things that Salam still gets credit, and I didn't know. But then I learned also how much involvement and passion has Eliezer dedicated to this project, which is you will see today in his presentation. It is a major initiative to put together a big experimental facility in the Middle East, with in Jordan in particular, and then with the participation from Iran again, Israel, Palestine, and so on. So it's a best example of what we can call, and people usually call, scientific diplomacy. And actually, because of that and of his many contributions, I think Eliezer was recently received a special award for scientific diplomacy from the AAAS. And so we are very happy to have him here and give us a general perspective and view of what SESAME is and the importance of SESAME. So please join me to give a warm welcome to Eliezer Rabinovici.
Thank you, Fernando, for such a personal introduction. And I would say, in general, those of you which had the opportunity to listen to my talks in string theory know that usually my talks are built on irrefutable logic, one line follows from the other. There is nothing to discuss or to debate. But this talk comes from another place. It's actually, you will see, it becomes more emotional. I get carried away during the talk. And so it's different, and it's a different, I'm very glad to be here, but I come here in a different mode than I usually am. Now, I must emphasize that everything I'm going to describe here is very personal. This is my personal view, my perspective. There is in Arabic and in Hebrew a proverb that says that success has many fathers and failures are often. I know the group of people which will be blamed if this finally fails, but the number of fathers can be very large, and my view will be very personal. I also call it, you will see why, a visit to a parallel universe. Now, after I have talked, I would like to give in two short videos, actually, the opportunity for the people involved in the actual experiments to you. And so I'm a voice for them. So I'd like to, you to hear them.
This is something I would like to leave to next generations. This is what I believe in. It has to work because it means a better world. It means a better world from many aspects in terms of bringing science here, in terms of bringing a line of communication. Maybe it will not bring peace to the region.
It is very valuable and it is very important for our region because we can, one country cannot afford to have a single synchrotron machine.
Here we are as scientists, and scientists usually belong to the humanity, not to the country. I understand that there are some political use of science, but we are not here for political use of science, we are here for science.
The work we do here can be used in many fields, including electronics, including engineering, including material science, so it will have many applications from cement to health.
What we hope is that science will open the door to for other or further understandings concerning other issues, okay? This is what we hope. I mean, we begin with science and somehow we will open the doors that are closed for years or for centuries.
Iranian and Palestinians and Pakistanians, scientists are my friends because they are scientists, so we have a common ground. The common ground is doing research. We don't care about what is your religion, what is the color of your skin. We don't care about that. We only care about science.
In science, there is no hostile, okay? We are scientists, we are academic people. We are not dealing on political issues.
I think SESAME is a modern technology which help two people around the Middle East to develop and improve their knowledge.
I imagine a war would bring it to a stop, but we've been pretty close to a war, or very, very high tension level in the last few years, and somehow we've managed to keep going.
It was always my dream that to show that Arabs and Israelis can work together for the benefit of humanity and for the benefit of their own people. Both sides having an interest in that. And for me, SESAME, in a way, is an incarnation of such a dream. Okay, so we are in a period of fake news. So this is true. These are true people. They are not boats or objects like that. And this was not a script. This were spontaneous things they said to this interviewer from the BBC. And I must say that from my point of view, half the way is already done if a group of young people can say such a thing. Now, in general, I'm very happy to see here many young people because I'm really mainly speaking to them. We live, or let's say when I grew up, in Jerusalem many years ago, we were brought up that we have to contribute to our country and we have to contribute to our neighbors and we have to contribute to humanity. This was put into our education. I think when I look at the young people around me, children or grandchildren, I think they don't have exactly the same view. I think when they look at the world, they view a very over-constrained system. a system in which they believe that their own impact is negligible. They cannot do a dent, they can do nothing to change the course of events anyhow, so they concentrate mostly in helping themselves, their dear ones, their families, and maybe a little larger group around them. And I see this all over the world. I mean, you can get major things out of this, major contributions, but it's more directed not as a motivation to help society at large. So for this group of people, I would like to say that you can make a small change if you are crazy enough, and I will tell you the qualifications you need, or minimal qualifications you need for that, but it's possible to do it. And one doesn't have to retreat to this narrow world around us. It's not necessary, and the world needs a different attitude. Now, I'll show you another film. That film already describes, because I'm taking for granted that you know what I'm talking about, which isn't obvious from here. I will go into that later. But you will now see how the place looked about half a year ago. And there will be more descriptions on what it is. It lasts for 4 minutes. Again, I do want to show it because you hear the voice of the people that actually this is for them. Sitting here in a building, around us are peaceful olive groves, and you ask yourself, what's special about this place?
We finally now have in our region this wonderful machine. I mean, we are talking about one of the world's most complex machines.
You can describe a synchrotron as a rather large light bulb. I mean, we produce light, which you cannot produce by other means.
And the aim is that we accelerate electrons.
The electrons are charged, and when a charged particle is accelerated, it begins to radiate.
At this point, they emit the full range of electromagnetic radiation from infrared to X-rays.
The radiation has very unique properties.
And because of that, we can study property of materials which you cannot study with a simple laboratory source. Anything from an isolated atom to a complex system like a human being.
You are allowed to study whatever you want. You just have to design your research in a perfect way that suits the experiment, and that's it.
SESAME started with a large group of countries involved. Many Arabs and Israelis sat together trying to think how they could learn about each other, using science as a tool for understanding, learning about nature, learning about the material world, and trying to understand it better together.
It was a 20 years course of action with many hurdles and ups and downs on the way, but we kept on pushing in order to bring SESAME to become a real center of excellence in science in the region.
We can collaborate. People from all over this region can do this together.
For now, we have the infrared beam line and the X-ray fluorescence beam line. We already had some results on life signs, like breast cancer diagnosis. We're working on cultural heritage, archaeology, bioarchaeology. We are studying mummies.
The first ever measurements that were done were on ancient individuals from this very region. We're exploring perhaps craft activity related metal uptake in bones and teeth.
I'm from Palestine, from Najah National University in Nablus.
I'm from Iran.
I'm from Egypt.
I'm from Turkey, from Ankara, Middle East Technical University.
it's not that common in our region that people are breaking lots of rules, and the rules are different in our region. So you have the society rules, you have the gender rules, and SESAME is an entity that is breaking all the rules, actually.
For me as a woman, and for me as a young student, it allowed me to think.
The best point of SESAME here in this region is that it can gather people from all nations here in this region. This is a very good point of this facility.
In a way, it will make us to compete with the other researchers in the world. So we will not just rely on the benchtop spectrometers, but we will have really valuable data, which could eventually be a publication, maybe in Nature or Science.
Next steps at SESAME is to see this place full of researchers.
I hope really that soon all this area here will be full with pipes and vacuum pumps and instruments.
So I think we are heading to full operation.
I wanted to grow to become an international scientific center and to do science and produce science here that is published in the most prestigious world-class journals.
My real dream is that the science here will be of very high quality and that people will say, "Ah, this was discovered at SESAME." Okay, and as Fernando kindly mentioned, this was recognized the following people, but it got the AAAS Prize. But the prize is really for SESAME. We just selected as five people. Okay, now what my talk will be, how will it be about? Well, I will give an introduction. I will then discuss real dreams, that is, how to make dreams into something real. Then I will discuss how one laid the foundations to enable to reach the point that you see here, and how the puzzle was put together. Because I'm a physicist, I won't avoid in some places to give hints on the type of physics topics that I work on. So I like to start this with a puzzle. I show you a photo, and I ask you to think, what do you think it is? And I should, at the end, be able to give you the answer. And if anybody knows the answer now, please don't spoil. I don't want to hear. Okay, so let's for a moment assume we are sitting in an academic institute that I'm giving the Science for Understanding 101. Now, I don't call it Science for Peace, even though it's a slogan, because I think that in the name of just and lasting peace, so much blood was spilled that let's leave that aside. And let's not talk about the peace here. Let's start with understanding. That's a very important step forward. Now, what do you need in order to come into my course? Because each of you was checked by a future scanner which reads your minds and thoughts and know exactly what you have to do, what you think about. So you have to have an infinite amount of optimism. And I will repeat that as we go on. If you don't have an infinite amount of optimism, if you will listen to your friends which tell you that there is no chance that this would work, it won't work. So you need to be, I would say, autistic in a way. You really need not to listen to a lot of feedback that you get and try and filter the ones which give you strengths. So that's a requirement from the course. Okay, we'll come back to that. But I'm sitting at ICTP, which is an embodiment of these ideas. So nevertheless, I will repeat, why is science a good tool for understanding, and why are scientists a good tool for understanding? So why science? I give you an example. I was director for 7 years at the Institute for Advanced Study in Jerusalem. And we had a meeting which lasted 10 months in which scholars from Christians, the Muslims did not agree to come, and Jews sat together to discuss the first 5 books of the Bible, of the Old Testament. And they spent there and were paid for 10 months. There were 8 people. And after 8 months, they viewed this as a fantastic success, and they continued doing it. What was their achievement? They reached agreement on 5 paragraphs of the 5 books. So they had a common, they agreed on a common interpretation of that. So, and that for them was probably something they never succeeded to do before. This is not the situation in science. When two scientists come together, they agree on Maxwell's equation. We are not going to argue the laws of how electricity flows in these walls. And this is crucial because we in modern society are filled with layers which come from the media, from our education. So when we see a person with whom we are at an adversary situation, we don't really see the person. We see all the images which we collected over the years from newspapers, from classes, from books we read. And when a scientist meets another scientist, he's immediately curious to be able to evaluate that person professionally. Does it make sense what that person says? Is it interesting? Do I learn something? Can I teach something? And I think that by doing this, one removes an enormous amount of static noise which differentiates people. Now, as you know with your colleagues, there are some colleagues that after you sat with 5 minutes, you don't want to see that person again. And there are others which you would like to see again and again and again. But this is just the human condition. However, from the point of view of being able really to see each other, I think scientists have this ability to see each other, evaluate each other professionally, and then it may move or not also to a more personal level. But I think that is why science isn't important. Scientists themselves, well, scientists in some fields are forced to collaborate by the problems that they have. Of course, there are some academics which value only sitting alone and they produce beautiful things. But in science, many of us are forced into collaborations. So the tool of having understanding of another person on a complex issue, building the necessary network to understand another person is there. And therefore, I think scientists can help in understanding and communication. And again, I have no illusion. I know that scientists range from terrible to fantastic Mother Teresa's. But that is not the issue. The issue is that we were equipped of tools of knowing how to collaborate. Okay, after saying in this course a general concept, and there will be more concepts, what are we discussing here? So we are discussing a light source like the one in Elettra here, and it was built in a way on the ideas on which CERN was built. Now CERN was built, came out in 1954. It had many goals, but one of its goals was to help heal Europe after World War II. The scientists on both sides were very busy in devising methods to kill civilians but also and soldiers on the other side, and then they had to come back together again. And it wasn't easy. We are trying to do the same thing in the Middle East. But in the Middle East, there is a great difference between that and CERN. In 1954, World War II was over for 9 years. It was clear who won the war and who lost the war. So building the structures were under a situation where there were certainties on what is going on. In my region, this is not the situation. The war is going on. Who is winning or who is losing the war may change on your daily mood and may change on your narrative, your perspective. So we have to build a common ground in a situation where we really are still in a real conflict. And this is, the conflict is real, there's no doubt about it. So this is very, very challenging. And this is what we tried to do. So I hope you remember that challenge when you compare CERN with its right now rather small 27-kilometer circumference machine, small relative to 100, and 100 meters deep. You know why it's deep, the students? Do you know why it's 100 meters and not on the ground level? Okay, that's one possibility. Another, that some air force would come and bomb it, but that's not the reason. It's the first stable geological strata. So it's very crucial to have stability of the beam line. So that's why they had to go 100 meters low. In China, if it will be built, one doesn't need. They have, the place they've identified is stable immediately down. So that is the reason. Okay. As you know, at CERN, the megalomaniac high-energy physicists think they can put, they can study nature, they can put all the equation on one slide, and they have some success in it. There are many places which participate in that effort. And there are many countries involved in that. That's CERN. So remember, this is now SESAME. This is the building. It's 75 meters by 75 meters. Kilometer is not a scale here. And this is where the light source is. Now, I really want mainly to mention the human aspects, so I will go very fast through the science. And one reason is I know very little about it. So the whole science of light sources is something which is very active over the world. A lot of very important results were obtained at various light sources. And they make a lot of use out of the fact that when electrons go around, they radiate. Now, I will mention here and mention maybe again, of course, to the Middle East, you will not bring a collider because collisions we have every day. That's not a problem. Much better to bring a light source, much more needed in our area. So here you have a list of things which I welcome you to photograph and absorb, which are very good uses for synchrotron radiation sources. Just so you know where the spectrum is, the spectrum is very wide. Unlike in high energy physics, the issue is not is what is the highest energy you can reach. This is not the point. There are many other parameters. There are many uses. I will describe some. So there, you see here that the energies involved and the of one photon and the wavelengths involved have a very broad region, and each region has its own specific uses. So this is a general machine, and then we'll reach how we reach to get it. There are many, unlike CERN, which was a real closure of Fermilab, there's only one lab of this nature in the world. There are many light sources in the world. This is a distribution. There are around 70 light sources in the world. I will discuss why it's very important for us that, unlike CERN, which is really dedicated for one mission, here there are many, many missions. The basin of attraction is very large. You can study medicine. You can search the structure of medication. You can look at the structure of materials. You can detect pollution using doing environmental science. You can do biology. Ada Yonat, which got the Nobel Prize for Chemistry, the messenger RNA structure was discovered on a light source of less quality than the one we have at SESAME. There is chemistry. There is physics, geophysics. There is archaeology. You can take papyrus. Several thousand years ago, you mentioned Crete, from Crete. That if you would begin to play with it, it would become dust in your hands. You would destroy it. You put it inside the light source. You can read everything which is written on it. So it's really a very powerful and versatile tool. Now, the members of this light source come from the following countries. So you see Turkey and Cyprus, the Greek, not the Turkish part of Cyprus, the Greek part of Cyprus. You have Israel, Palestine, Egypt, Jordan, Iran, and Pakistan. These are the members. And now, right now, I'll describe the journey. All of them are sitting not as entrepreneurs, but with the license of their government. Everybody there is sitting with their parliament approving it and with the government approving it. Okay, what are the objectives? So I said it many times. They were written also, but it's always good to repeat. So one wants to foster excellence in science and technology in the Middle East, reverse the brain drain, enhance the regional science and technological infrastructure, and contribute to improve understanding of people coming from diverse backgrounds. So here are some photos from the journey. This moment here is very special for me because, you know, dreams are made out of fluffy stuff. And here this becomes metal. So touching this metal, this was delivered to CERN to be built and tested there by CERN SESAME teams, was a very special moment. One could touch it, it was real. These are the boxes put in Jordan. These are the teams which put it together. Just, I think I show it to myself to be sure that it's real. And then eventually it even worked. This tells you that no short circuit around. The electrons actually move. Okay, now how did we reach there? So let's go back to concepts. So the first person to introduce this, as you said, was Abdus Salam. And here I give you the reference, not just the statement. So it didn't appear in Science for Understanding. It actually was an appeal to the Muslim world in order to be able to jump the big barrier and reach the more advanced knowledge. He suggested, and this is down in red, this was an attempt to emphasize it. He suggested to be able to build a light source in the Arab world, which would help make a jump. So this is the first time I think that somebody identified the light source as a vehicle that a society and the scientists in that society can really jump forward to the forefront. And I think that was full of insight. Okay, where did Salam's picture disappeared in my rearranging, so it's somewhere there. But you can look at the wall, and you can see it. Okay, so the dream was of the first director of ICTP. Now, Eleanor Roosevelt said, "The future belongs to those who believe in the beauty of their dreams." Nice to believe that. Ah, here he is. So I just switched these two. Now, beautiful dreams indeed are rare, but they also come for free. And the issue and the work is how to actualize these dreams, if to actualize them, and then how to actualize them. So we are back to Science for Understanding, and as I told you, infinite amount of optimism. I give you here a graph. I don't think if you see the red, can you see the red? If you see the red, it's the mood in the region. And it violates, I think, Rolle's theorem by the fact that it has many more downwards than upwards. At least psychologically, one always feels that it's a new down is coming. On the other hand, if we look at SESAME, which is the green envelope, it started from nothing and it became real. So this is, on this background, if you would read the newspaper every day, look at television, no matter if you sit in Italy, in Tehran, or in Jerusalem, no way that such a thing can work. So as I said, you really need this infinite amount of optimism. I also would like to say that the project is kind of unique, and I'll try to demonstrate it. First of all, very high quality scientists are involved. And this time, I'm not blowing my own trumpet. As I told you, I'm a string theorist and know very little about that. But the experimental scientists and engineers which were involved in bringing us to this place are really of the top quality. The science we should aim be of very high quality, and I will discuss this because it will be very important along the road. And I think the dedication here of this group of people is quite unique, because given our surroundings, we should have all dropped it a long time ago. And nevertheless, the same faces appeared again and again and again. Here are some names of Israeli scientists involved. Above are the ones which did things on administrative level, but the two first ones work on light sources, and the rest are scientists which work on light sources. Okay, so let's say you want to do a common scientific project, which is something we were actually thinking about here in Trieste a while ago, and I'll come back to that. So how do you do it? One possibility is you go to the people who really understand everything. Here they are. And they go to the people they think are the right scientific advisors. And they tell you that they would give money to you if you work on that project. So this is the top-bottom approach. Then there is the other approach, which is the bottom-top approach, that the scientists, which know or think they understand what the important problems are, they come to their bosses, and depending on the culture, they may say it politely, they may shout, they may turn the table on the other person, but in whatever language is in their culture, they tell the other people, you must put money in this so that there will be progress. Now, my approach, I must say, is bottom top. I have no trust that in the top that they are able, on many issues I don't have trust, but definitely not that they can give directions in science, and I think it's the scientists which should give the directions. Okay, now the question, what type of science to do? Small science. So ICTP is an example where small science made an enormous impact for decades and educated generation of people all over the world. And this, I must say, is my favorite thing. Then there is big science. Big science is CERN, big science is SESAME. Not on the same scale, but much bigger than the scale we are discussing when you discuss just interhuman correlation between two, three, or four people. Okay, now those who know me well know that I hate to compromise. Even on one potato is not easy to compromise. However, on this issue, I had no choice. I had to compromise. My choice would have been small science and bottom top. And I will describe to you our effort together with ICTP, CISA, to do this. But it ran into a wall, which I will describe. So I realized that in my region, it's impossible to do science which is not top bottom. You need the umbrella of the government in order to collaborate. Otherwise, it's difficult enough with an umbrella. But with no umbrella, it is not going to happen. It cannot be like collaboration between friendly countries. It doesn't work that way. And governments are interested mainly in big projects. So to go to small science is very difficult. One has to go and do the large science thing. And for me, it was very difficult to compromise. There is one thing, however, but I did. But there is one thing which we did not compromise on, which cost us, I will describe, was that you have to do good science. And I want to say this again. I think ICTP, again, is an example. You're doing here forefront when you have now the spring workshop, you're doing forefront research. You're not going to somewhere easy. You're going to the top, trying to be at the top. And the same should be of any collaboration of this nature. I think it's better not to do a collaboration than to do a mediocre collaboration, or worse than mediocre, just to say we did a collaboration. No. If you do it, it has to be the really top quality science. You must make every effort to make it top quality science. So on this, there is no compromise. In addition, in my course, I would say that each side, in order for a project to work, it's essential that each side is essential. Each side can bring a contribution which is useful. Now, if, let's say, God forbid, there is a plague, so, and in some country which is not developed, then, of course, you bring from a more advanced country a group of doctors, they give the inoculations. People don't understand the microbiology of why it works, but they saved and they go. That's okay. But I think if you really want to build a long-term understanding, it must be on the same level. So you must search for projects where each side is essential and each side can benefit. This is crucial for such projects to work. I also learned that Marlon Brando in his movie The Godfather was right. It's all personal. And I will give you some examples where it was people which you never heard their names and will never hear their names, but said in a position where they can make a decision and they help the project go in a positive direction. So I will come to that again, but it's important for the young people who want to, I will say here, elaborate a little more for the future. If you come to someone, it's a wonderful idea, of course I will establish a committee to study it and so on, forget it. You have to find in the organization a person who has the capability to decide on his own. He may afterwards have to quarrel inside the organization. But he or she can decide on their own, and she can say, yes, I give you the money that you need. And or I make the decision which is needed. And I will give you some examples of where that happened, of watershed moments, where people for reasons, okay, I would say they were good people because they agreed with me, so that's my definition of a good person. But in any case, they followed the route which they believed was correct. So it's all personal. So the first personal thing for me was Sergio Fubini, a very well-known, well-respected particle physicist, which I knew as a legend. And thanks to my friend Daniele Amati, I got also to know Fubini a little more, not only as a legend. And we had discussions, and he viewed me as a naive leftist. Okay, if I'm naive or not, okay, that's one issue. If I'm a leftist, I can decide on my own. But in any case, he came to me after the Oslo Accords were signed, and he told me, look, your naive ideas, maybe we should try and investigate them now. Maybe now is the time to do it. And this was at CERN, and he told me he loved to give assignments, so he gave me two assignments. One assignment in a symposium for his 65th birthday was, and this is Sergio, the late Sergio Fubini. One thing, he asked me to give a mini review on several new aspects of string theory. I highly recommend, Paul, that you read it, because it has in it the necessity of having not just strings, but higher dimensional objects to appear there. And as you see, why strings, and et cetera, why only strings, what else is possible. I think it was an excellent review, if I may say so. But the main thing was that he asked me to go and research all Arab-Israeli collaborations there. Maybe I put here a word. When it started, it was Arab-Israelis. The fact, we were very delighted when our Iranian friends came in Uppsala, and when Turkish came in. But in the beginning, the idea was much more simple. The Arab-Israeli collaboration after Oslo Agreement. Not we didn't view the region in its entirety. Okay, so he sent me to do this. I did it. I went to the president of the Israeli Academy because they had a center in Cairo. We still have a center in Cairo, which is part of the Camp David Accord with Egypt. And I was told there that nothing works, you should know. You're wasting your time, don't do it. I said, okay, what happened and so on? Okay, there were some things which were success. My lesson from this, for example, was the marine sciences in the Red Sea. The marine sciences worked very well. It was a collaboration between Egypt, Germany, and Israel. And it worked well because the Egyptians were fantastic phenomenologists. They knew the area in an outstanding way. And Germany and Israel brought the more modern equipment there. So each side was essential. You wouldn't know where to do the research without the Egyptians. And the Egyptians benefited and learned a lot about how to study marine biology. So my basic take-home lesson, which I reported in Torino in this event, was to say that you need to have a project where both parts contribute equally. Okay, guided with this wisdom, we went together to Egypt. We went Sergio Fubini. We went Jane Rostanz, the secretary of CERN, myself. We went there, and we signed an agreement with the Egyptians, under the umbrella of which we had many people together. Now, this agreement, this was in a period when you still had disks in the computer. So the Italian embassy in Cairo had a Macintosh like the one that we had in Jerusalem, so all the corrections could be done on the place. We didn't need to wait for the secretaries to with Tippex to correct all the mistakes. I mean, this generation doesn't know anything about it. But once these were stumbling blocks, highly non-trivial stumbling blocks. And we signed together with Alberto Devoto, actually, was also a key person. We signed an agreement to have, and you see it's very important to sign an agreement. Now, I, by the way, signed an agreement under no authority. I was chairman of the department at the time of physics, which gives me no authority to sign agreements with Egypt. Sergio Fubini had no authority whatsoever. And the only person with authority was the first undersecretary of state in Egypt, actually. So we signed the agreement together. And the decision was, first of all, we get to know each other. It's a period of small science and bottom up. So we tried that. The first thing was we had a visit, you see Sergio Fubini here, of Egyptian physicists to the Hebrew University. You can see how many years have passed if you look carefully at my photo. But it's many years ago. And I'm sure Albert Einstein would approve. This was a portrait of him looking at us. And we came up with a problem which Fernando faces every day. Per diem. We have here the Egyptian scientists. They come. The budget in Egypt is very small for science. Who will pay for their hotel? Who will pay for the meals? I can't do it for my research grants. They're not for that. So that was a very tough moment. That was a watershed moment. Okay, Sergio took, I don't know why he had a check with him. He took it out and said, I'll sign a check. I said, come on, Sergio, you get a CERN salary. I get an Israeli salary. This is not how the organization can work. This is not a solution, okay? I'm not going to sign checks like that. So what we did, instead, we called a number, or two numbers, actually, at that moment, from this office, 5 minutes after this photo was taken. Both numbers were in Trieste. One call was to Miguel Virasoro. I told Miguel, I called, because Sergio was reluctant to ask favors. On Sesame, I have no inhibitions, as Fernando was mentioning gently. So I went and I said, look, we are doing this. We are in trouble. We need money. And anyhow, this can't move ahead if we don't have some serious seed money. So he asked, how much do you need? I don't know why I said $22,000, but I said $22,000. He said, okay, I'll send you a letter, and that's it. So he was a person, he could sit and say, well, I have to convene the council, and we can discuss it, and then why not give it to A, B, C, or D, why give it to this? Nevertheless, on the spot, he decided, and with this, he removed a major obstacle. The other telephone was to the director of CISA, asking him, okay, can you also help a little? And he said, yes, I won't enclose, say the amount, because he may be put to trial, I don't know later about that. But Daniele also, it took him a full 2 minutes to say, yes, please, I support it, and you have it. So the moment these two answers, yes, came from Trieste, from two institutes very near about, we were able to move on. Otherwise, it would have been the end, a nice visit, and that's it. I also want to mention Galieno Denardo, who played in meetings which happened a key role, very positive, very supportive for the project. Okay, then Daniele, Miguel, and myself sat in the house of the Viaci, which is not this one, I hope one day, but it's a house which we were renting during a visit here. We sat on a table, it was a nice summer day, and we were asking, okay, let's build the program, and mainly, let's make the Let's make the logo. You know that logo is very important. So this logo was done on the table in, I don't remember if it was Daniele or Miguel which made the drawing, definitely not me, I have no talent for drawing. And we put here in Italian physics, in English, in Arabic and in Hebrew. And this was the logo of a meeting of a very high quality, which we convened in Dahab in Egypt. And if you look at the names of the countries which agreed to spend money, you see together Palestine, Egypt, Israel. I don't think ever before or ever after they appeared as funding agencies of the same project on the same billboard. Maybe one day with Iran will appear also. So here you see Cairo, Amman, and of course, Italian institutes. Italy played and will play a key role in this. Okay, the meeting was under, it was, if you wish, a Hollywoodian production. I would say an Austrian Schmaltz. It had a red tent, Bedouin tent. Nevertheless, the way it started was unbelievable. Venice Gauda, the ministress of education of Egypt, told us the way she started the meeting was everybody stand up for 1 minute of silence to commemorate Yitzhak Rabin, who was murdered by an Israeli 3 weeks earlier. So you had over 100 people from Palestine, from Morocco, from Jordan, from Israel, all standing 1 minute of silence for this. This was a fantastic gesture, which I think gave the direction of the whole meeting. Okay. We had support by international people from CERN, from Princeton, all on the background of the Bedouin, discussing like you are discussing in the spring school. You have here serious discussions in this red tent. It appeared on the CERN Courier. This is Jacob Ziv, the president of the academy. In Israel, he invented the dot zip. If you ever used zip, he's the person who invented it. And the reason the poor person had to go all the way from Jerusalem to come there was because he made a bet with me that nothing will come out of what I do. So the result of the bet was that he had to come and be part of the opening. This was taken, the picture was taken by Maurice Jacob, who also spent there. Well, by then I learned that you have to sign agreements. So we signed a detailed agreement on the future. We had an umbrella which covered every possible collaboration. And this was actually the high point of small science, bottom top, because we really influenced here with the opinion of the people. Okay, unfortunately, about half a year later, while we were planning a big meeting on El Nino, I remember Miguel was very interested then in climate, and it was supposed to be on El Nino, which had a lot of effects in various places in the world, and we had already all the lecturers, it was all ready to have the follow-up meeting. The money was available, everything was there, but then one of our wars with Lebanon started again, and the whole atmosphere in the region changed. I should mention that the ministers of education, when we met her in Cairo, told us the chief, Mubarak told her to take politics out of science. So he made a political decision, take politics out of science, collaborate, I don't mind. And that enabled the Egyptians which were interested to collaborate. However, after the thing in Lebanon, the political decision was bring back politics into science. So this collaboration was over. We could not do that anymore. We retreated with no dignity from the area, which was where we wanted to be. We had to retreat, and we retreated, where not, to Torino again, to Villa Gualino. Maybe some of you have spent some time there. And there we asked ourselves what to do next, and one of the things we had in mind, in addition to particle physics, was also had to have a light source. Now, the idea of having a light source, I will tell you afterwards who brought it to us, was not in our main line because we were high energy physicists. And I should say that actually an Israeli-Palestinian agreement about Palestinian involvement in ATLAS experiments did work. Also, Sesame doesn't get a lot of publicity, which has its merits, but that definitely got no publicity, but Palestinians worked in the Israeli group and in ATLAS, which was one good thing. Now, in Israel, we don't live in houses, we live in apartments, and I have neighbors, and they heard about it, so the neighbors were kind enough to drop their opinion on what I'm doing. So this, I see that I have a neighbor who is very conscious. I don't know, he didn't put his name, but he's very conscious because he puts the exact date when this appeared and so on. This is not just something he printed on his own. And where he says that the Egyptian press is anti-Semitic, and okay, now I know that, and actually it's true. There is a large extent of Egyptian press, which is very unpleasant to us. But I think if we count all the negative things, we never move forward. You try to identify the positive things. You don't put the emphasis on the negative. Here was the discussion on having the first time we were thinking on the possibility of having beamlines. Yeah, beamlines and detectors for synchrotron radiation. We thought maybe we'd think of bigger projects because the smaller ones don't work. And it was at that meeting that the late Gus Vost, a German scientist who worked in the US and in Hamburg, came, and he said that there is a machine in Germany that is going to become, it's called BESI, which is in Berlin, which is the Germans are going to junk. And why isn't it a great idea that we bring a synchrotron to the Middle East, which is that machine? And they came up with this proposal. Okay, so we have failed with bottom top. We have now to go to larger science, and let's look at this problem. So what are the advantages of the suggestion of Gus Voss and also Herman Winnick from Stanford? The suggestion is a light source is a place where you can have in the Middle East, in our area, a critical mass of sciences which is credible. If you build, let's say that an oil-rich country gave money to build a CERN or an FCC in the Middle East. For the scientists in the Middle East, we don't have a critical mass to start starting it. On the other hand, if you think of a light source where so many branches of science can do experiments, there is a possibility to build a critical mass. And actually, one of the only advantages of waiting so many years to doing it, we did build and educated a large critical mass of people to do that. So it isn't a good idea to do a light source. It will enable to build a credible critical mass. We went to Uppsala, there for the first time we met the Iranian representatives and the Turkish representatives. At that stage, Fubini left and Hervik Schopper, a director general of CERN, took over. He recruited Khaled Toukan, which you saw on the movie before, which is a Jordanian, which played an essential role in the motion. So now we head on the table. And now this is a test to the class. We are given an old, defunct German machine. Should we take it or leave it? What does the vote say? Should we take an old machine, which the Germans don't want anymore? Should we bring it to the Middle East, yes or no? He's always a contrarian. Okay, so of course the answer is no. No way we should do such a thing. No respectable scientist will want to come and work in a machine because scientists, as you know, and it's good, are selfish. They want also their research. They sometimes are willing to look at a broader aspect, but they care about their research. So let's say Ada Yonat would say, no way, I'm not going to touch a machine which has been thrown away. So no way to take it. And as Daniele said, we took it. Now, why did we take it? What was the logic behind taking it? So the logic was dreams, as I said, are made out of fluffy material. By the time now, it's not just an Arab-Israeli issue. We have Iran, we have Pakistan, and we have Turkey. These are countries which don't usually collaborate on anything positive. So how to build a framework to do such a thing if you have nothing to talk about? Nobody will agree to discuss with you such a thing unless there is something concrete. So we took it as something concrete. Now, when I was a postdoc in the US, I learned that in the US, a company, which this is broadcast, so I can't say the name, developed a tactic which is called bait and switch. In other words, you write a sale that you're going to sell, this happened to me, 4 tires for a very cheap price, but when you arrive to the shop, unfortunately, they've sold them all, and now you have to go to something which is much more expensive. So this was our idea. we are going to take this machine and build around it the administrative structure, because we cannot work without an administrative structure. And then we will tell everybody, come on, if we did work together to build an administrative structure, you will not let us work on such a machine. Unfortunately, the tactic didn't work that simple. And for many years, Sesame was stained by the fact that people in key positions, including the European Union, said, this is an old machine. We are not going to give any money for that. But I still don't regret that decision. We had no other choice. We had to make it something concrete. We went in 1999 to Paris. It was one of the not nice experiences, because then the diplomats came in, and they played their usual tapes of attacking each other. So we tried to minimize having diplomats around. And at that stage, one would have to have a decision of where to have the machine. So there were requests from many countries, and I won't now go through the whole list which requested it, but in any case, in the year 2000, the 15th of March, I went to Amman to a hotel to discuss with Khaled Toukan where Israel would like to have this machine so we can participate. So Iran volunteered, but we know that it's a one-way ticket for Israeli scientists, so it's not realistic. Armenia suggested it, but it's not realistic for anybody to travel there. We wanted something in the region. Okay, so it was, as I said, the 15th of March 2000. This was before the Second Intifada. I went to Amman. I discussed with Khaled Toukan. I told him, look, Israel will support Jordan, but under one condition, that you will appoint a Palestinian director general. This is the one condition. Khaled Toukan, now it sounds unbelievable, okay? But this was the Israeli decision. It was not my own. This was a consultation. And we said, we will support Jordan if you have a director general there, which is Palestinian. Khaled Toukan, who comes from a family, he came earlier in the 20th century, but he comes from a Palestinian family himself, Toukan. So this was agreed upon. Now we had to decide where in Jordan to do it. So even though I come from the Hebrew University, I have a soft heart to Weizman Institute as well. And I said, it needs to be a place where scientists from Weizman Institute, which are further from Jordan, can put in a sample and in 2.5 hours be there with a postdoc, a student, a professor. So we went through the places. No, you need a map. Okay, so Toukan sent his helper to look for a map. Now, I don't know if any of you, how many visited the Middle East. Do you think there was a problem when he brought the map back to find the place where to have it, which is from Weizmann, Rehovot, a certain distance? Israel doesn't appear on the map. So you just have this big vacuum there. So it's not so easy to identify. Okay, so I used my advanced geographic knowledge and where actually we measured, and the decision, we had a common decision on where to do it. On my way back, I went by Jordanian Airlines. Now, I think one way you can distinguish a theoretical physicist is you give him a paper or her a paper in his profession, in his area of research, and you know that in 1 minute he will look at the references. Is he referenced there or not? So I'm sitting in a Jordanian airline, I want to see, do I have a reference? Does Israel exist on the map? So you see, there is a place to make for Palestine. There is a place for everybody on this map. But somehow, there was not enough place to put the word Israel. So I know that I'm not naive, and I know that the world is complicated. And nevertheless, I say, this should not block us from trying to move forward. Okay, I'm showing you now the original designs from Jordan. There was a competition at CERN where this should happen. And this is the original designs. The Jordanians wanted it near Amman in a place called Allan. These are where they presented it. This is the place. On 11th of April, not far from today, it would be almost 19 years ago, we went to CERN. I there was a whole story, which I can't say when it's recorded, on why it happened that the Palestinian DG was not elected, but it was not Israel's fault, and Jordan was chosen as a site for the place. Then the council approved that Jordan would be the place. And the advantage of Jordan was stable in our relatively, nothing is very stable in our region, but a relatively stable place, and had free access and guaranteed free access to all scientists. So any other country, there would be problems. Either it would be too far away, or there would not be access for all scientists involved. So we chose it. Okay, we started the switch. We said that the old German machine is not what is going to help us, but in the meantime, we shifted in June 2002, quite a while ago. Now, both of us, Munchen, work on complexity. So I want to give you an example of complexity. So, okay, Professor Matsura became the Director General of UNESCO. To become a Director General of UNESCO, if any of you has the vision to do that, it's good to come with a dowry. So Japan gave a dowry to UNESCO, and this put money at the discretion of Matsura. That means he can make a decision without going to the General Assembly. So Hervik Schopper convinced him to give money for what? For scientists in Novosibirsk, so they don't play other games, give them money, they go to Berlin, put it in boxes, put it on this ship. The boxes, I call them Lego boxes, because it says install 1 into 2 and 2 into 3 and 3 into 4, put them in a place in Jordan, and you have the machine. Now, till today, most of that machine is stored there. The only part we took from there is the booster, which we need, but is now a part which really needs to be replaced. But it did allow us to be this nucleus around which we built what we did. In January 2003, there was an inauguration of the place in the presence of the King of Jordan, and the royal court in Jordan was very supportive for SESAME from the beginning, and was very generous in its donation. This was the original idea. You're more familiar about LHC, Atlas, CMS, LHCB, and Alice. It works here differently. There are many beamlines. You can go and visit Eletra. It's a different type of design and arrangement. So what you see in the middle is a circle where the electrons accelerate, and then you see the beamlines. Bahrain at the time was involved, now it's not anymore. These are all dreams. I mean, these were designs, not the true thing. This is what the Jordanians said they will do. Okay, and then it started getting built. And it was built by Rafik Saraf, a Palestinian contractor working in Jordan. He actually built the place. Because we live near earthquake country, like Slack, you need to have very solid foundation. So it was a very complex thing to build the foundations of the place. And here it is, a visiting group coming. And here I'm taking you for a short visit from Israel. I know your Hebrew is not good, but you can listen nevertheless. So this is a ride. You go through a city called Asalt. It's about 1 hour from the border with Jordan. You go up the mountain and you reach the place, and there it is. Then 5 years later, the building was ready. Now, okay, come on. You spent a lot of time on ADS-CFT, many of you, right? Many of us. So we all know that the boundary is enough, right? If you have the information, we can call about firewalls, but if you have information about the boundary, you know to build definitely a lot of the bulk, right? Okay, so here is SESAME from outside. We have a well-defined boundary, okay? It's not a sphere, but one can work on this boundary. This is inside. Do we need to fill it? I think any serious believer in ADS-CFT would say it's redundant. I mean, we already have all the information on the boundary. So it kind of tests your confidence. And this is, was really very, very problematic, because for years, this was the situation there. There was no money. The Jordanians gave money for the building, but there was no further money. So now you have to put the puzzle together. So Chris Leyland-Smith, another director general of CERN, agreed to take the baton from Hervik Schopper and moved on. I think till today, maybe a little regrets. He didn't realize into what he enters when he enters the Middle East, but I would say it in the opposite way. The presidents of our council up to now were Hervik Schopper, Leyland-Smith, and Rolf Hoye, all of them director generals of CERN. I think there are very few places which can say that they were given the trust, that people were willing to give the precious time after they retire from an important job to spend between the crawling people in the Middle East, sit there and bring a project. So I think this really reflects the trust, and I hope we stood up to the trust. James Gillis is a person who brought the Higgs to 1.3 billion people by doing the, public relations for CERN. So he is now volunteering also time with the agreement of CERN for SESAME. Okay, this was a bad situation. We brought in Nobel laureates to write to the European Union to give money, didn't help. So we began to build the bulk, but now also we should remember when we build the bulk, not all the bulk is the same. So what did we build there to fill it? We filled it with shielding radiation, but there was nothing inside which would radiate. Okay? There was no machine, but we built the shielding, so at least it doesn't look so empty, and it's much cheaper.
Most of the programs that you do try to do in this region to reflect some show of cohesiveness are actually artificial. They try to show people meeting together, kids playing together. That's not real. This is a real thing. Everybody thinks he's benefiting from it.
Okay, so you don't know to read Hebrew, so you don't see the next question. This is one of the sharpest TV interviewers in Israel who came here, and he's speaking to Professor Salman Salman, which is a Palestinian. And the Palestinian is actually saying very positive things about the project. He says this is a real thing. It's not just bringing children together to play. So then the commentator says, what do you mean it's a real thing? It's empty. What are you talking about? So his answer, which he got cut off, it was, if people want to fill it, it will be full. And he was right. Okay, now I want to give you one incident. I like to study singularities and their role in string theory and if they are resolved or not. So let me give you an example of a singularity. End of a contribution of a small person you never heard of and will never hear again about. So it's the 1st of June 2010. I'm waking up at 4, I arrive to Cairo at 3 o'clock in the morning. I like to sleep late. So I woke up at around 11. I opened the TV and I saw on CNN that Israeli commandos have attacked the Turkish fleet which came to Gaza, in particular the ship Mavi Marmara, and that there are supposedly heavy casualties. Okay, there were no more details. The meeting started 2 hours later. Okay, I can't again because people hear everything. I can't say everything, but I can say the following. In the meeting, a certain representative of a country said, I want Israel to be condemned. Sesame should condemn Israel for the attack on the Mavi Marmara. Okay, I think that the president of the council should have stopped it at that point because we have a decision. We don't discuss political issues. We don't condemn anybody. We discuss science. We can, in the evening, condemn whoever we want, but we don't. It's not part of our policy to do condemnations. I stood up and I said, if we consider this discussion, I'm leaving. I have no interest. I'm not a diplomat. There are many organizations which I'm sure are going to deal with this in the future. I'm wasting my time if this is what we are doing, and I'm afraid Israel will leave as well. Okay, again, instead of being stopped at that stage, it continued. And the certain delegate who wanted to get the condemnation turned to the Turkish delegate. This is the Turkish delegate on the left side, Ulko Dinsel. And he said, what do you say? Now, when I was a child, I read the books of Perry Mason, who is a lawyer, lawyer detective stories in the United States. And one of the things which he taught his assistants, never ask a question that you don't know the answer to. So in this case, the question was asked, but he didn't know the answer a priori. So Dintzer could have said many things. He's a diplomat, he's not a scientist. He could have said, I need to call Ankara, I need to make a committee, I condemn everything. Instead, he said, look, I have a story to tell you. I don't know if the story is true, maybe Paul and Fernando will eventually confirm it. He said, when the British Academy was formed, it got stuck for a long time discussing religious issue, and it didn't go anywhere. So at a certain stage, there was a decision, let's do here science and humanities and forget religion. Let's not discuss religion. And from then, the British Academy flourished. Okay, my proposition, he said, is we, even though people of my country were probably killed here, my suggestion is we don't discuss politics at Sesame. The moment he said it, the whole thing evaporated. So here was a person which had the foresight and the courage, because again, he's a diplomat. Diplomats don't make policy. They tell you what the government's policy is. And he took the decision to say, let's leave it. So he, at this moment, he saved Sesame. So again, it's all personal. I don't know. I met him several years later. He remembered very well the moment. And he said, I thought it's the right thing to do. So having these people which do the right thing is rare, but they help move things. Okay, it's still, I hope you enjoy our shielding. It's perfect. But now we need to build up the bulk. So at this stage, I took an initiative. I spoke actually with the Egyptians, the Turks, and the Jordanians. And I said, if I bring money from Israel to kickstart, I don't put the Iranians in a position to have to answer me such a question. So if I find a way to get $5 million from Israel, can you also get money so people see we are serious and we give our own money to build things? So I went to the finance ministry. You see these two guys? Nobody in Israel knows them. Not their name before, not after. There, in Israel in general, in the finance ministry, is a group which we call Naarei Haotzar. It means, dismissively, the kids of the finance ministry, because they have a lot of authority. They can decide which projects to support and which not. I came to them, I told them about the project. I was sure they would throw me away. They said, take us to Jordan. And here they're sitting in Jordan. They came back and they said, if the other countries contribute, we agree to contribute. So a letter came out from Israel telling Professor Khaled Toukan that if other countries will contribute, not naming, just saying other countries contribute, then we will agree to go. And then we were very happily in a way surprised that somebody in Tehran said, we want to give also. And this was very helpful because Egypt was before Mubarak when they said yes, and afterwards total turmoil, so there was no answer. Okay, so we had a meeting, and now I want to show you something which is rather unique. On March 10th, 2012, it's a small room in Amman, and you will see together representatives from Turkey, from Iran, from Israel, and Jordan, and the ex officio, a Palestinian and an Egyptian, and it takes 28 seconds. Each country pledges $5 million. Now, you know that these countries are not the usual bedfellows. So to have them in the same room together, each committing this amount of money, is something special. So here it is. This is the Egyptian ex officio. Salman Salman you already met. He was ex officio. These are the Turkish head of the Atomic Energy Commission in Turkey. Jordanians, these are the two Iranians, which I'm sure you recognize. And then, one is the Israeli, the one for whom it's easy because he doesn't sign the check, but next to him is the one who signs the check.
So let's see, I've signed all.
That's it, it's all over. And this was another watershed moment because the moment that happened, finally the European Union listened to us after years of not listening and telling us that we have an old machine. They agreed to give €5 million to CERN, where teams of Sesame and CERN would test magnets so that they can be used at SESAME. Afterwards, Italy came in again in a crucial way. I won't say that none of you heard of Nando Ferroni. That won't be true. But I think in many other places, nobody has heard about Nando. And he actually volunteered in a two-minute discussion I had with him. His Erice, he agreed to give the money. He said, how much do you want? I said, 5 million. He said, okay. I remember his immortal words, I'll scratch the bottom of the barrel. Okay, I didn't know if it's serious or not. He approached me in the evening. He said, the minister wants a half-page document about it. And that's it. Italy committed the amount of money, out of which 4 million have been used. I don't know if the full five will be used, but 4 million have been used. So this was really a watershed moment, because now, with a shoestring budget, we could go forward. We could have the magnets. We could begin to have the machines. This is now 2015. Has components from many countries. These are, again, for me to be sure that this is real, and it is. We're approaching the end, so I do that. Then on May 16th, 2017, there was an inauguration. Again, I'm sorry, I'm showing a picture of myself because that's what I kept. And that's but there, as I'm sure that there are in other paper, different pictures. This was a ceremony. This is with Khaled Toukan. This person was there in Dahab, and Edward came again also to the ceremony here. And do you recognize this person? Carlos Moedas, he was the commissioner for research of the European Union. He totally, personally, because he was a good friend of somebody called Gago, who was a student of Schopper. And he personally turned around the policy of the European Union and made it a major donor to SESAME, very important. So it began to work. The machine is working. We are training people. You have, again, the big support of Giorgio Paolucci, was at Electra. Hattel from Germany was crucial in training the people. You see lots of training. Here you see the building. Now, nobody asked me a question about Photoshop, because this building, which I showed you, had two different roofs. Once it was, in some of the photos I showed you, it was gray, and in others, it's green, okay? This was like in a physics seminar when you try to slide something and nobody caught it. But okay, how did that work? So I think we were tested from above many times. I'm sure Daniele remembers the earthquake in Dahab. People, it was a 6.9 on a Richter scale earthquake. We were in Dahab. In Nueva and Sharm el-Sheikh, people died. We were protected. There was a group of people which went to Mount Sinai and saw it shake. So I think the signals from above were very clear. Now came another test. On the 15th of December 2013, it snowed in Jordan in an amount that what we say in Israel, the elders of Jordan do not remember such a snow. Now in normal places where snow is an everyday occurrence, you know when you have snow on the roof, you clean it. There the whole roads, the roads were stuck, nobody went to the roof, and as a result, the whole thing collapsed. But we again had a protection because there was nothing inside except radiation shielding. So no damage was caused. Okay, so this is why we have two colors of roof, and to change luck, now we put this roof. Now these are the beam lines. You don't have experts here in this. I will just say that on day one, there are two beam lines, number one and number two, that there have been 103 proposals altogether. To work there. Countries here, you see Cyprus, if you are interested, you see 12 from Iran, you see 4 from Israel, from Italy, from Jordan, Mexico, Pakistan. And now there's already on the 11th of March this year, there was a decision. So from your own country, you can see how many have been on one of the beam lines have been approved, and this is on the other beam line what has been approved. So actually, we are going to start having the real good quality machines starting to work and experiments being done. Now a few slogans. Slogan number one, I think that the scientists and their drive broke boundaries and took the project and their countries to where no one had the right to expect. Okay, but I think the main thing is that once the governments realized where they are, they didn't blink. This is a surprising thing. This, my big fear was that once they begin to realize where they are, people all over the region would say, forget it. But they didn't. They let this go on. Why? Maybe one day I will know. I don't know why in my country, and I don't know why in other countries, because I see all the forces in both sides which would say, stop it. And nevertheless, it goes on. Then this is something I show now in the United States, because Europe, the United States, all of them have very clear vision on how our region should work. Every detail, ask them, they know the answer. But then when they're asked to give money, suddenly they begin to stammer. It's not under the right umbrella. We don't know. We don't. So this is what the Pakistani said about it.
Science which requires money.
You don't hear anything.
Means is the political will. Now, don't ask me more about it. But
which means
my
ask
point
me.
Is that you have to have political will.
So
otherwise, the sum of 25 million euro is maybe less than the cost of an F-16.
Okay, so this was really for many years not understood, but Europe, as I said, changed its attitude and is very positive, helping. And these are the people in Europe responsible for that. Again, one name you do know, but the other name of Bernard Fabian, I'm sure you don't know. And he played a crucial role at an intermediate level to do it. And this is the amounts of money which were given up to now, which is it's beginning to accumulate into real money. Our situation in the US, we visited a wing of the White House once, Obama, twice, Trump. The Trump administration sounded more positive than the Obama administration. So maybe something will happen. This was less than a month ago. I'm not sure what is going to happen. From my point of view, the future, I think we did something which maybe nobody expected. And as true mathematicians, we showed an existence theorem. It's possible to do that. People from the region, scientists, driven, can do such a project together and work for two decades together. Okay? So that can be done. Nobody can tell us it can't be done. We showed it can be done. But eventually, we will be judged, I think, by the quality of the science. And this is a very big test now. And we are working on a shoestring budget. So this is still a problem. On the good side, I would say that we are the first from February 2019, this year, we are the first green accelerator. We are totally driven by solar power. Okay, I can explain why we had to do it, but it's a fact. So we are the first accelerator which does that. We have ICTP help for things that Fernando mentioned. This is a nice place to visit. Now, I'm sure many of you envy me for my tourism, like in Petra, which is the only time I did tourism, because the council met on my request for my wife that it be in Petra, so we could see Petra. Now, this is if you see such a picture, I think it depicts more about our region than what I showed you before. Okay, I'm not naive, things are complicated. We don't live in a neutral area. And nevertheless, things go forward. Now I come to near the end. What is this? Okay, I will tell you what this is. This is a single person. The background is black, like in our region. But there are spots of white. The spot of white here is a person. It's a Jordanian worker who is trying to put in foundations for something different. And he's sticking in the steel into the concrete. And there will be more poured afterwards on it. So, and the light somehow shines from him. So I have this in my living room, in my dining living room. And I believe this is a good representation of our situation. Background black, but a small source of light which is white.
בועה מוזרה, קצת
I finish with this.
מהמציאות שאנחנו מכירים. בן שני, חזר השבוע מירדן.
I'm sorry for the Hebrew, you have to improve it. But
So what is the moment that you are waiting for?
To see the light.
The light?
We call it the light.
The light at the end of the tunnel, huh?
The light at the end of the tunnel.
I think this is the most appropriate way to end it. I think many people in the young generation, the region, are waiting to see a light at the end of the tunnel, and we should try and help them whenever we can. Thank you.